So, you pulled a bunch of new cards in the Dazzling Divas banner in the hope to pull some Jewel Knights, maybe even some Oracle Think Tanks. But let's face it, you probably got a bunch of Bermudas and Angel Feathers you didn't want to play with. Do not worry, I am here to tell you that Angel Feather are good, actually, and that you can actually build a really good, really fun to play, and fairly easy to climb deck with the cards you didn't even want. So today we're going to be looking at a what I call a vanilla Celestial deck. What does that mean, and why do I call it that? Well, there are lots of different decks you can build with Angel Feather right now, and later, I'll go into some different options, like maybe a more budget sort of deck and that kind of thing. And eventually, later on, once I've played around with the new cards enough, I want to be able to build like the best possible Angel Feather deck at the moment and show you how that works. But like I said, these cards have only been out for like a day at most. So what we're going to be showing you today is the Celestial deck, and what it is. The reason I call it the vanilla Celestial deck is it is literally just the act of throwing all the cards with Celestial in the name into your deck and then just hoping it works. So we're going to be showing you that. It's going to be very unrefined. And luckily for you, dear player, it's not going to be using many cards from old sets at all. Which means, like I said, if you've opened a bunch of packs today in the hopes that you can pull like a different clan or whatever, then chances are you can probably already build this deck, or at the very least get it to a point where it's fairly cheap to rent. And so that's what I'm going to be showing you. So let's go into build deck. Now, first of all, actually, before I do that, I will say you're going to have to spend 50 V medals. That may sound weird. Why would I have to spend 50 V medals? Because the skin is mandatory. You can't use this deck without the skin. I'm sorry. How does that work? Trust me, it just works. If you use the Suiko skin or any of the old skins, you just won't win, basically. I don't make the rules. So, okay, let's look at what we've got here. That was a bit of a joke, by the way. As you can see, I got some pretty bad pulls. Earlier, I opened 150 packs and I got literally zero copies of these two grade 2 units, but if you've pulled a similar amount of packs for this set, you should be fine. Off screen, I opened like a handful more packs and got another SP Zerachiel, so I'm very happy with that. I've got two of those, and that's also added with the two SP Anneals I already got, so we're doing pretty well on the SP front. So that's good. So this isn't gonna. So, I will bear in mind, right? This is, as I mentioned, the vanilla Celestial deck, right? Later on, I want to build the best possible Angel Feather deck at the moment, or at least my favorite possible one. But like I said, that's gonna take a lot more play testing and like tweaking individual cards. I want to get it just right. This is the just. You take every card with Celestial in the name and then slap them in because that's how an archetype works. For anyone who somehow doesn't know and is new to trading card games, an archetype is when cards share the same or similar names and have effects that like chain off of each other. So, for example, in this Celestial deck, you're definitely going to need lots of different cards with the word Celestial in the title for the effects to start chaining together and working. So that's kind of how this works. Right now in Vanguard Zero, that is the best way of building a deck. You want to pick a clan, pick a word. So you're like, I like Narukami, I like the word Eradicator, and then you just throw together all the cards with the same name. And luckily for Angel Feather, as I mentioned, honestly, this deck's not bad. It's pretty good. Now, of course, I think we can do better in a future video, and it is pretty expensive. Look at the amount of triple rares. But like I said, if you're someone who's already opened a bunch of packs with this new set, you should be able to build this pretty fine, or at the very least rent it fairly cheap. So, what is this deck? How does it work? Why do I recommend it? So, the Celestial deck is really cool because Angel Feathers work by giving you control of the damage zone. That's like their unique property. Cough, cough, unique. I saw that new Bermuda Triangle card, fucking standard format TCG. I'm gonna... whatever, whatever. That's a tangent for a different day. Angel Feathers' unique ability and gimmick that they revolve around is supposed to be that they have control of their user's damage zone, which means you have lots of cards and abilities that allow you to take cards in and out of the damage zone at will. And what you're doing with Celestials is you're taking advantage of that to give your units pretty huge numbers so that you can swing at them. Basically, have you ever had a full field and you start attacking your opponent's vanguard, but then, uh-oh, they get a defensive trigger, and now none of your units have, like, high enough power to actually get another attack in? Well, the whole point of Zerachiel is that if you use it correctly, that shouldn't be a problem. Even if they get a defensive trigger, you should still be able to get some hits in on them anyway. And that is satisfying. And that's one of the reasons I recommend Angel Feather, because it's a difficult clan to do much in. About, or at least against, because they're so unorthodox. Like, for example, like, there are ways of preventing your opponent from setting off their combos and doing what they want to do with other clans, right? Like with Spike Bros and Narukami and all those other clans. Like, there are tactics and strategies you can kind of use against them to throw them off their game and stop them from doing what it is they want to do. With Angel Feather, there's, like, no card that's like, hey, stop your opponent from putting cards in and out of their damage zone. And there's no card that really, like, stops Zerachiel from overcoming your Vanguard's power. You know, like, it's a very spiteful deck, I guess, and that's what makes it so fun. And that's probably why Wrecker is the one who ends up running Angel Feathers. Because it's very, like, haha, you tried, you can't really do much against me, I'm kind of doing my own thing. Of course, that does make the deck a little bit RNG. There's, you know, it's not the most consistent deck in the world. You are going to definitely need specific cards in your hand. And that's why you're going to want to mulligan in a very specific way. So there's that to take into account. And it's a very thinky deck. It doesn't pilot itself. You really have to think hard about which cards are going in and out of the damage zone and which cards you're riding at any given time. But that gives it a higher skill curve, which makes it a lot more fun to play. So it's been a few minutes already. Let's actually talk about how this deck specifically works. So again, I'm not going to justify why certain cards are in here. The justification is they have Celestial in the name. There are a couple in here that don't have Celestial in the name, but for the most part, these are going to have Celestials in the name. And if there are any cards here that you're missing, I will recommend you cards to switch out, whether they be other Celestials or whether they be older set cards. So let's go into the start of Vanguard. So I've went for Peniel, mainly because she's a Celestial, right? So she allows you to call a Celestial from your damage zone and put the top card of your deck into your damage zone. If called face down, it must be called put into face down. It's a Celestial. It allows you to put stuff in and out your damage zone. You can probably see where we're going here, right? So that's another thing we should probably say. So your plan is you want to get Zerachiel on Vanguard. She's kind of your ride target. She's your break ride too, because ideally you want to be riding over Ramiel. And then what you do is you use Zerachiel's ability to give yourself massive power. So if Solidify Celestials or Zerachiels in your damage zone, it gets all units get 3000. So that's what you want to do. It's kind of difficult, because basically what you want is you want to get two Zerachiels and put one of them in the damage zone and then ride the other one. That's the big strategy this deck revolves around, and that can be difficult. Because a lot of other decks and clans, like, let's just say MLB, because that's a deck everyone's familiar with, that only revolves around, you know, riding out MLB. And that deck has a lot of deck searcher cards. This doesn't really have many deck searcher cards, and you need to get two of your target grade free. That's kind of difficult, but there are some things we can do to make that easier. First of all, I mentioned mulliganing earlier. If you get any Zorakias all in your starter hand, you hold on to it. Fairly simple, right? And then you just hope that you can just draw into the other one. So there's that. Let's take a look at some of the other. So the perfect guards. This is Celestial Anneal. You can use the other perfect guard, but I'd recommend against it. If you can use Anneal, then you should. Mainly because it's got Celestial in the name. As I mentioned, most of the effects work around and revolve around having Celestial in the name of your card. So this perfect guard is just straight up better than the other one. If you really don't have this one for whatever reason and still want to run this deck, the other one works. It's still a perfect guard. You're just going to have a little bit more trouble setting off those combos. But again, it's not impossible. So next we've gone for Abaraki. If your Vanguard is a Celestial, it gets 3,000. Fairly simple stuff, you know. It's a 7k, so in the back row it can still, you know, push for quite high damage. But also, you know, a secret with Angel Feather, a secret, is that you actually kind of want to be a lot more aggressive than you'd think. You'd think Angel Feather, oh, they're a defensive clan, you're healing yourself a lot. You want to kind of take it slow and just heal yourself a bunch, take control of your damage zone, and just hope you can endure the match. But honestly, no, you kind of want to be throwing those heavy punches early on, and this can get an extra hit in turn two, right? Like, if you play your cards right, it's risky going for the front row grade one, because your opponent can just get rid of it, and grade ones are a very valuable resource, but it's definitely an option if you're going aggressive, and that's something I would recommend. Now we have a Yagon. If a Zorakiel is in your damage zone, you can discard a card from your hand and draw a card. This is basically giving us our draw power, and it's allowing you to discard cards. Now, discarding cards is really good, because basically you're controlling what cards are in and out of your damage zone. It's pretty simple, right? That's kind of what you want. And there are lots of effects and skills in this deck where you do need certain cards in your damage zone. Or also, you can just kind of get rid of a card you don't want and hope that you can draw a better card, basically. So that one's fairly self-explanatory. The only downside is that you do need Zorakiel in your damage zone already for it to be worth much. But like I said, it's a 7k grade 1, so honestly, even if you can't use its ability, it's not awful. And honestly, that artwork is just gorgeous. Look at that artwork. That's really nice. Then we've gone for one copy of Hesedriel. If you have a Zorakiel in your damage zone, it gets 3,000. You could go for four copies of this and skimp out on the other grade ones, but I don't like this one as much. This one has just gone in there purely because it's a Celestial. If you want to put one of your ponies in there, go ahead. The ponies aren't Celestials, but they're better than this card, basically. And speaking of cards that aren't Celestials, I've put in a copy of Nocion, mainly because even though it's not a Celestial, it allows you to put something in and out of the damage zone. And that's your bread and butter. That's what you're doing in this clan. So having one copy in there, if you don't, just put in any Celestial that you don't already have four copies of in. And then there's your, you know. So here we go to the double rare grade 2s. So Raggiel gets 3,000 if your Vanguard is Celestial. This is really good card, because your standard like grade 3 boss unit is going to have a vanilla 11k. And if this gets 3,000, which it's almost guaranteed to get, by the way, because you're going to have a Celestial Vanguard by this point, then you are getting an extra hit in on that Vanguard with no boost. When I said that the Celestials revolve around hitting high numbers, I really meant it. A grade 2 doing 12k with no boost, that's really good. Then we go to Sariel. You can counterblast to put any card from your deck into your damage zone face down, and then put a card from the damage zone into your drop zone. So again, that's basically your Nocion. If you don't have this card, or you really don't want to run this card, it's basically just Nocion. You can use Nocion instead if you really want to. This has a added benefit of, well, being a Celestial. So, you know, give and take, basically. You got to decide what's important to you. And then you've just got the 10k Celestial. It's a Celestial 10k damage. You can't really beat that. It's very versatile. It works in basically any situation. There's not going to be a time in any game where you're not going to be relieved to see a vanilla 10k Celestial. So we've gone for Himiri's here. And Himiri's is not a Celestial, but Himiri's allows you to put it into the damage zone after attacking to swap it out for another card in your damage zone. This is really good because it allows you to multi-attack. And Zorakio's ability, allowing you to give all the units on the field extra power, means that multi-attacking is a lot more viable. So you're going to want that one copy Himiri's in there. If you don't have it, put any other card in there, really. And anything works. You can put a Metatron in there if you really want. Shamseel also works. Just any Celestial you don't already have in there, basically. Anything works in that last slot. Himiri's is probably your best bet. So here's Zorakio. You probably know the deal with Zorakio, you know. It's the unit that makes this deck work. You want to be getting it out onto your Vanguard as your break ride, preferably. It still works as your normal ride, but you want it as your break ride. You want to ride it as your limit breaking over your other grade 3. You can counterblast 2 to get 5,000, and that's really good because honestly, you're not counterblasting that often with this deck. There are a lot of other decks that are very counterblast heavy. This specific one doesn't have that many counterblasts, so just using them up to get extra power, which, once again, remember, your opponent's probably going to get a defensive trigger, and that basically ensures that you're going to be able to climb over it no matter what. That's kind of the real appeal and strategy of this deck. And also, again, it allows you to control your damage zone. Be careful, right? Be very, very careful. Unlike most other cards like Metatron, when you swap out a card from your damage zone using Zorakiel, it has to be in the same rare guard circle. So if you swap out something from your back row with something that you wanted to put in your front row, tough luck. It goes in your back row, and this happens during the battle phase, so you can't slide it up and down between the front and back row. So you've got to be really careful about positioning. Like I said, this is a deck with a higher skill curve than most Oonga Boonga Eradicator decks. You know, so you've got to put a little bit of thought into what you're doing, but it's definitely worth it. So then you've got Helm. Helm allows you to counterblast to put a card from your hand to your damage zone and add a card from your damage zone to your hand. If you added a face down card, turn that card face down. This unit gets 5,000 until the end of turn, and if a Helm is in your damage zone, it also gets a crit. You can counterblast to get 2,000. So basically, this is another Zorakiel, really. It's just another Zorakiel. So if you don't have Zorakiel, you can't get it. Helm is fine. Helm does almost everything Zorakiel does. It just doesn't give the entire board power. And that's the only difference. So basically, because of the fact that Zorakio is kind of difficult to pull off because you need one on your Vanguard circle and in your damage zone, and it doesn't look like you're going to be able to do that, Helm is a pretty good alternative. You know, you still have some options if you can get Helm out instead. And also, it's got 11k. So as a front row rare guard, 11k, pretty good, you know, all things considered. And then here's Ramiel, who you're wanting to break ride your Zorakiel over. So when you ride Zorakiel over it, you get 10,000 until the end of turn. So once again, that's you climbing over your opponent's defensive trigger. And you can look at the top 3 cards of your deck, put a card from your damage zone, and return to the rest of your deck. Then add a card from your damage zone to your hand. When this unit attacks a Vanguard, it gets 3,000 to the end of battle. So again, as you can see, we're swapping things in and out of the damage zone, making sure we got the cards we want. And then we're also gaining power because of it. That's kind of how the deck works. It takes a few attempts to get the hang of, but that's kind of the whole swing of things. So, what triggers have we gone for? So, 4 heal triggers. That's pretty obvious. We've added those to Ramiel. Because Ramiel, yeah, you preferably want to get it out before Zorakion Helm. But if you can't, it's not the end of the world. You know, it's a bonus effect to go on over Zorakiel, but it's not mandatory. So ideally, you can get away with mulliganing it away. And that's what you want the heal trigger to be. You want the heal trigger to be a grade 3 that you're not going to lose sleep over mulliganing. And Zarakiel and Helm, you're probably going to keep a hold of them as you get a copy of them in your hand, assuming you have the other cards you need as well, because you need two of them to actually use them very well. So that's why we've gone for the heal trigger. Zarakiel I've put as a stand, mainly because you get so much power, right? Like, for example, this unit gets 12k, which means that if you have a grade 1 behind it, you know, you can attack with it, and then stand it using Zarakiel, and then attack, boosting it, and you're gonna get those attacks through, basically. This is one of the very few decks where I think stand triggers actually work. However, you are still gonna need that draw power, so I've put everything else to draw triggers. Again, refined to taste, basically. If the stand triggers really aren't working for you, then 9 draw can work, but I think one thing that's really important with this deck is having the extra attack power. And, you know, Zarakiel is boosting your numbers so much, it would be kind of stupid not to take advantage of it. And again, you're not really going to get the stand triggers that often anyway, because you're basically already admitting that you're going to be giving up two of the Zarakiels anyway, because one will go in your damage zone and the other one will go in on your Vanguard. So you're only realistically going to likely pull 2 stand triggers per game at most, and that's assuming it's a game where you pull basically all of your triggers. So it's not that often, you're not really giving up that many of your draw triggers. So that's what I've gone with. That's the vanilla Celestial deck. Again, refine with to taste, you know, just kind of work with what you've got. But as long as it's looking kind of like this, it should actually do pretty well. So let's get into a game and show you how it works then. Okay, so we're going against a Bermuda Triangle player, huh? This is probably someone who's also playtesting the cards they just got. In fact, actually, this does a pretty good job of showing, of letting me show you why Angel Feather is the better deck to go for, rather than Bermuda Triangle anyway. So, as you can see, we've got a handful of grade 1s and 2s. If you get a Zarakiel or a Helm, you might want to keep a hold of them in the Mulligan. But anything else, I'd say any other, like, grade 3s should kind of get rid of. I know it may sound weird because it's like, but aren't I going to want those grade 3s? Well, honestly, the way this deck works, you're kind of hoping you draw into your Zarakiel anyway, basically. It's very much a go big or go home. And as you just saw, we got our Zarakiel anyway. So we're going to go for that 7k grade 1, just because, you know, anything that's not the Perfect Guard is fine to go as your first ride. It doesn't really matter. That's a pretty good one to go for. Like I said, it doesn't really matter. As long as you're getting that first attack in. If you want to really be cheeky and you have that second grade 1, you can try and go for a second attack there. Just beware, they will definitely block it with a trigger. But it's worth a shot if you really want to go aggressive and you've got an abundance of grade 1s. I don't. I'm mainly with grade 2s. And honestly, I'm going to use those grade 2s pretty quickly. That's kind of why I mulliganed for them. So they're going to get a couple of attacks in, and that's okay. We can take that. In fact, again, funnily enough, with Angel Feather, that's good. You want to take some attacks and you want to get those draw triggers, because that's going to give you options. You know, the draw triggers are going to, well, they're going to increase your hand size, obviously. But also, you're filtering some cards into your damage zone. And that's good because, you know, ideally, like, if you just don't get attacked, if you never receive damage, you can't really do very much with Angel Feathers. So you're kind of working with what you've got, really. So call out the vanilla 10k. And then that's allowing me to take advantage of Peniel's ability. So I put that in the soul, and that allows me to get another grade 1 out. And that's good. And then we managed to get very lucky, admittedly, and use that ability to filter a Zarakiel into our damage zone. So we're doing really well at this point in time. And now we're using this ability to get rid of our Sariel. Honestly, Sariel's not a card I'm particularly fond of. I've only really got it in there because it's a Celestial. We're keeping hold of our Rakiels because they get the 12k, if you remember correctly, if you've got a Celestial Vanguard. And like I said, you're going to have a Celestial Vanguard. You're going to have really messed up with this deck to not have a Celestial Vanguard at this point. And as I mentioned earlier, this deck is around about, like, it's about getting high attack numbers and stuff. And as you can see, we're getting a lot of attacks in here. They got a defensive trigger, but that's fine because we can deal with it anyway and get a trigger. Is that luck? Not really, you know, having triggers isn't really luck. Because that's just kind of part of the game. See, they got a heal trigger anyway. So we're just kind of dealing with it, but again, at least that's one less heal trigger they have to work with. There is one thing I'll say, if you want to swap out your starter Vanguard for the one that gives you the recyclable heal trigger, go for it. I wouldn't personally recommend it in the vanilla Celestial deck, because that gives you a little less control of your damage zone. But because, for example, the Celestial starter Vanguard we went with was the reason we managed to get that second Zoranquil into our damage zone in the first place. And now that we have another Zoranquil on hand, basically our plan is to ride our first Zoranquil and then use our second damage checked Zoranquil to use the first one's ability. So we're doing really well, basically. We've already set up our victory win condition. We just gotta let the game play out now. So now we draw, we get a perfect god. That's cool. But instead of going for Zoranquil, we're gonna go for Ramiel first, because of course Ramiel allows you to break ride on top of it. So we're being patient an extra turn. You know, we could have got the Zoranquil first, but we're gonna play the long game. We're gonna take advantage of this. Luckily we do still have a lot of grade 2s, basically. Goes without saying, grade 2s, they allow you to intercept. So if you've got a lot of grade 2s, you can kind of afford to act a bit more recklessly with this deck, because those will kind of protect you a bit. So I'm taking a little bit of time just kind of deciding what it is I'm doing. I decide not to throw up my No Seal because it's not really going to serve us very well here. And once again, we're getting those high damage numbers. That grade 2 with no boost managed to attack my opponent's grade 3 Vanguard. And for that, I am very, very thankful, because I didn't have a boost to spare, honestly. And, oh look, we didn't get a trigger, that's fine, we can still attack them anyway. See, that's kind of the appeal of this deck. Even though they're able to basically heal anything that we're throwing at them because they've just got really good trigger luck, I guess, it doesn't matter because, well, we're still getting attacks through anyway, and they're eventually going to run out of those heals. So, now it's moving over to their turn. And at this point, I'm realizing, wait, I don't fully know how this Bermuda Triangle deck works. I think the exact thought that was running through my mind was, well, I know Bermudas work around bouncing cards, so I guess they're probably gonna break ride and bounce cards, maybe? I don't know. But whatever, regardless, it doesn't matter. You don't need to know that strategy, because Angel Feather are the superior clan. I always see Angel Feather and Bermuda get bunched together, and that's not fair. Angel Feather's better. There, I said it. Oh god. Anyway, goes back to our turn now, and we've got Helm. Helm's an option, but of course, Zoranquil is the better target grade 3 anyway, and we've got a Zoranquil in our damage zone, so there's no real reason not to go for the Zoranquil. If we had a Helm in our damage zone and no Zoranquil in our damage zone, maybe it would have been a more difficult decision. We're gonna place out No-Seal, use No-Seal's ability for basically no reason, really. We're just kind of putting a perfect guard in and out of our damage zone. We're taking a second to read and refresh ourselves on Zoranquil's ability. Never be afraid to just kind of take a second to think about things. We're giving ourselves that extra power. And that's to ensure that even if they get a defensive trigger here, which they won't, we would have still been able to get our attack with Zoranquil through anyway. And I think that's a risk worth taking, because we really want to apply that pressure. We don't want to give them any room to breathe. We want to get those attacks through. Especially considering that our No-Seal is only really going to be able to take out their grade 1, which is still good, but it's not great, you know? So we kind of needed to get that Zoranquil, that attack through. And if using some counter blasts to guarantee it, well, if that's what we have to do, then I guess that's what we're going to do, you know? So they're going to send out whatever, who cares. They got a fairly big hand, and they send out a grade 2. So that's kind of interesting. They've got a much bigger hand than I do at the very least. And they're going to be kind of stupid. See, okay, so I'm going to give you a dirty little secret, and I probably shouldn't. because I'm an Angel Feather main, so I don't really benefit from this. If you are playing against Angel Feather, it's probably in your best interest to get rid of Rare Guards. If you can get rid of Rare Guards, you're doing pretty well against Angel Feather. See, they're making the mistake of just going straight for my Vanguard, and it's working pretty well for them because, you know, they're getting crit triggers, but I can block that fine. See, Angel Feather, whilst they can be aggressive, and whilst the Celestials are an especially aggressive version of Angel Feathers, Angel Feathers still, their bread and butter is being able to fend, being able to control the damage zone, being able to heal. And so, applying damage to me isn't actually that good, because if anything, that only gives me more options, because it gives me more cards in my damage zone to play with. I would say one of Angel Feathers' biggest problems, or at least something that can be kind of sticky if you don't know what you're doing, is the draw power. So I would say if you're playing against this deck and you're having trouble playing against it, get rid of the Rare Guards if you can. Because if they'd have got rid of my other helm, I might have been in a bit of a difficult situation here. Not the worst still, but like I definitely would have been in a less desirable situation. So we're going to attack. They're going to get a perfect guard. That's fine. We're going to attack. And I think they have another perfect guard here. I get a stand trigger. And see, this is why you run stands in the Celestial deck. Because I can stand that unit. And whilst it won't be able to get another attack in... Oh, do I go for another attack? I think I do, actually. And this is where I realized I kind of messed up. See, I should have practiced what I preached, because I just said that what I should have, what they should have done is taken out my Rare Guards. And I was so, like, I was like, oh, I can totally get this attack through. There's no way they have that many Perfect Guards. I'm just going to go for it. But then they did, and it's like, in that position, it would have been better to go for the safer option and get rid of the front Rare Guard. Because now I'm in a bit of a sticky situation. I'm not doing too great. You can tell that I'm not doing too great because I start like checking my what triggers I have left. But I managed to, you know, I managed to block that. And we're not doing so great. As you can probably see, we're about to lose. Oh no, this deck isn't very good in the first place. But you forget, Angel Feather are doctors. So that's fine. I'm just going to use their abilities to heal myself. Come on. What's the point of playing a doctor clan if you can't heal yourself? Come on. You really think I was going to get gotten that easy? I mean, I totally planned that, wink wink. So now that we've done that, we can basically just tear their asshole wide open. There's not much they can really do here. They don't have a hand to defend with. And I, you know, see, if I wasn't being so obnoxious, I would have placed down that grade 2. Because then, hey, if they somehow miraculously survived, then I would have still had an incentive to defend with. But let's be real. Even if they got a heal trigger, I could still climb over it using Zoranka's ability here. Because look. Look at those power numbers. See, Angel Feather may be a defensive deck, but like, look at those power numbers. They're still also perfectly offensive. So, I'll see you later with some more Vanguard Zero videos. Give the deck a try. Tell me what you think. And I'll see you later with some more Vanguard Zero videos. And remember, for every statement, there's an asterisk.